Thank you for coming this way. Hope you've had a good day. Appreciate what the Lord has done for us this morning. But we pray the Lord bless you this afternoon as well. I know we got a lot to pray about, a lot of people on our prayer list. If there's anyone needs to be added at this time, let us do that. Would ask that you do continue to remember Brother Elwood. He is going to be in Collinsville Nursing Home, so uplift Brother Elwood. I know that Miss Eileen Engel would continue to want you to continue to pray for her and the decisions I'm sure she's going to be making here in the near future. I believe she goes the 23rd of this month as well to Birmingham, so let's continue to remember those needs. Miss Diane's still in the hospital, so let's pray for her and do continue to remember our Vacation Bible School that'll come up here on us before you know it. It's already going to be here, but pray and be here Thursday if you can, if you'd like to help out in that. And contact Miss Kathy if you need to. Seniors, by the way of announcement, be going to the Magnolia House. Be leaving here at 12, is that right, or 11? 11 o'clock. If you want to ride the bus, ride over to Scottsboro. Good place to eat, I hear. I've tried it a time or two. And I look forward to seeing you there Saturday. Anything else before we go any further? Yes, ma'am? All right. Thank the Lord for that. All right. Pray for that need. Anyone else? Yes.
I think it's Tuesday.
I'm sorry. Tuesday. I read it in a bulletin this morning, forgot. But Tuesday. What time are you going to be? 5 o'clock Tuesday. 5:30. Just come when you can. Tuesday, Thursday. Just come on. All right. Anyone else? Any other announcements? If not, we'll ask our young men to come forward. We'll take up our evening offering. All right, let us pray. Dear Lord, we come to you with thankful hearts, thanking you for the opportunity once again to gather. We pray that you'd bless the offering. Father, you'd use it for your kingdom, for your glory. I pray, God, you'd help our church. Lord, we pray that you just continue to bless in the singing. Father, we pray that you'd bless our hearts this afternoon with your word. God, we ask you to help us the remainder of this week. Anything to be accomplished, we glorify you. God, we just give you praise in all that you do. We ask these blessings in Jesus' name. Amen.
Roll is gone. right, as the choir comes down, let's stand a minute, fellowship, and we'll get for some good preaching here. So everybody would stand in fellowship.
We see that the Son of God is there, as he is transformed. We see Moses, we see Elijah, we hear the voice of God, and we see these three disciples. So there's seven individuals that are involved there upon the mountain. God the Father, God the Son, two Old Testament characters, and the three from the New Testament, Peter, James, and John. So it's something I believe is being revealed to them there as they see the glory of God. But yet, we see here that there's these two individuals, and that's what we want to focus on this afternoon, these two individuals that are there. And I believe it's very important because Moses would represent the law, and we know that Elijah would represent the prophets, and we understand that our Bible really points to one thing, the fullness of the death of Jesus on the cross of Calvary. And there we're seeing that that's what they're talking about. That's the importance here, that they're talking about his decease or his exodus. That's what that word means. So you see that they're talking, I believe, maybe as they're there, this would give confidence to the Lord, and that may be encouraging him. You know, he's about to face the cross. But here are these two individuals. We understand that the Old Testament talks about nothing can be established without two to three witnesses. And it's going to be established here by these two witnesses that you see, a lot of people think the cross was just an afterthought. But really, the Bible points to the cross. It talks about the atonement of the sacrifice of the Savior throughout the prophets, the Old Testament law. Jesus said, "I didn't come to do away with the law, but to fulfill the law." So these two characters, you know, you'd say, well, why these two? Why not any other two? But yet these two, I believe, are significant throughout the remainder of the New Testament. These two individuals. Now, a lot of theologians are divided on the Revelation chapter number 11. Remember, in the latter part of the tribulation period, that the Lord said there was going to be two witnesses that will preach until his coming. So this possibly could be Elijah, and it could be Moses, really pertaining to the signs and the wonders that are given. They are not going to be harmed. They're going to be resurrected. They're going to be killed. But up until that point, God's going to keep them safe. And if anyone comes against them, they can bring fire from heaven. And that's what Elijah did on Mount Carmel, is it not, when he called down fire? You see, he really led an exodus himself out of rebellion, of serving Baal and serving God. But yet, here these two witnesses in Revelation chapter number 11, they're going to preach, they're going to do signs and wonders, water's going to be turned to blood, I mean, there's going to be plagues, and I believe that points to Moses. So you see here, these two witnesses, these two have testimony, and I believe that they really speak to us a lot about what's going to happen later. So we want to see that this afternoon, just for a few moments, and then I'll be through. There, the Bible says in verse number 31, they appeared in glory, and they spoke to him about his demise or his decease, his exodus, how that it should be accomplished in Jerusalem. So here, that's what they're talking about. And let me tell you, everything points to Jesus Christ. In our Old Testament, through the law, and the Old Testament, through the prophets, our New Testament points back to the cross of Calvary. There is where everything about humanity changed. That we could be saved by the life and the death and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. But let us just focus here on two witnesses, as Luke goes on to tell us there, that there was also two witnesses there the morning that they came to the tomb. And what did the two witnesses say? There, the Bible said they were in apparel of glory as well. It was bright and shining and white apparel. Now, we don't know that this is Elijah and Moses, but I just suggest, it's a possibility that it could be. But there's two men there, and they ask, "Why seek ye the living among the dead?" So there, we see that it's there. And did we not see two more men in the book of Acts? They're there. You men of Galilee, why stand you here gazing? The same Jesus that you see. I mean, he's coming back in like manner. I mean, there's two men. They're witnessing to the fact. They're witnessing to the fact of his death. They're witnessing to the fact of his resurrection. They're witnessing to the fact that he did ascend to heaven, And Revelation chapter number 11 is the witnessing of the two preachers there, which we believe that it is Elijah, possibly, though we can't be dogmatic about it, they're not named, but according to study and according to the characteristics of those two witnesses, possibly it's these two here. So they're preaching about what? And they're going to be preaching about the second coming of the Lord. So you see, they talk about here his death. They talk about his resurrection. They talk about his ascension. And they preach about the fact that he's coming back again for the second time to sit on the throne of David and to judge the nations there in Jerusalem. So they are witnesses, are they not? I mean, they're leading up to a testimony. But here's what I read into it this afternoon. I hope that this will help to you. These two men, what do they really testify to you and I tonight out of this passage of Scripture here? Now, as we said, the other two witnesses are up for debate, but yet there's two witnesses. Possibly it could be Elijah, it could be Moses. But here we know that they are identified as two individuals, Moses and Elijah. What does that say to you and I tonight? Well, the debate of the world is there life after death?
Amen.
Is there eternal life? Moses, at this point in his time, would have been alive on earth somewhere around, as I've studied this, somewhere. Some scholars say 1,400 years, some say about 1,500 years. And here's Moses standing on the mountain. Okay, Elijah probably been dead about 400 years, some say around 500 years. So here is Elijah standing on the mountain. There they are. Is there life after death? Boy, thank God we as Christians can draw faith from the witness here of these two men on the mountain that our loved ones, by the way, that have gone on to be with the Lord, they're alive and they're well. That's what it says to me. I don't know about you. But it says it's amazing to me what people believe. It's amazing. There are religions that believe in incarnation. They believe that how you live your life this time will be how you come back the next time. And some of you are going to come back as rats if that are true. No, I'm just joking. But anyway, they're there in a human form. I mean, it's amazing that, is it not, that they believe that our parents and our loved ones come back as cows or come back as, you know, raindrops or flowers. I mean, we believe that the Bible says that there's life after our exodus from this life. I like what Paul said, my departure is at hand. When he's about to leave here, he doesn't talk about dying, he talks about departing. He's going to exodus from this walks of life into the next walks of life, and there he's going to be in the presence of God Almighty. That's what the Bible said. To be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. Now, I can't explain to you what kind of body they have, but here it is amazing to me that Peter said, hey, after they leave there, they're talking, after the cloud speaks and says, this is my beloved son in whom I'm with, please, you better listen to him. Amen. And by the way, that's still the only way to get to God the Father is through Jesus Christ, his Son. So you better hear what he has to say because it's of utmost importance. So these two individuals, I believe, they testify to you and I tonight about something grand, I believe glorious to me and you, and that is we believe in the coming of Christ for the rapture of the church. What do you mean? Well, the Bible says Moses died and God gave his body. We know that because you said that Satan wrestled not with the archangel over the body of Moses. We don't know, and I told why God hid the body, but we know that he died when he told Joshua, my servant Moses is dead. We know Moses died. He went, by the way, off the grave. Now, we know that Elijah, what does it represent? We know he didn't die, did he? We know that he was talking with God there. He went home in a fiery chair. And there, I believe, would be a picture of those that are raptured. I mean, those that are caught up. But whether we go by the way of the grave, when we go by the way of the rapture, the song says we're a winner either way. Amen. What do you mean? Those that have gone on to be with the Lord, where are they? Well, Moses and Elijah is there. Now, I can guarantee you, I mean, this would be a say to me, preacher, what's the glorious about that? Is that the Bible said in heaven we'll be known as we're known? You know, when we get there, we're not going to ask, we're not going to have to ask who's this and who's that. I'm only going to recognize our loved ones that are already there and that have been transformed. The Bible says they appeared and talked to him, but yet they appeared about that. But I want you to see, as they appeared unto him, that the Bible says they appeared in their glory. What do you mean? They have a new body. And boy, that's looking good every day, is it not? And to talk about a new body there they stand. Peter recognized them. Peter knew exactly who they were. They had a body. There is life after death. And then I like what the Bible said here. As they're communing with the Lord Jesus Christ, they're aware of what's going to transpire on earth. It's something that could be said. Is they're aware in heaven today what's really going on according to the plan of God? Does the Bible not say that when one is saved that there's rejoicing in heaven? You know, I believe God just opens up their ear over there and lets them know one of their prayers has been answered and their loved ones have been saved. And the whole heaven breaks loose in jubilation and rejoicing over the fact of one sinner has come to repentance. So these men are witnesses to you and I tonight that here one, if either we go by the grave or we go by the way of the rapture, we're going to receive a new body. Amen. A new body. And it's going to be a body that's recognizable. Now, Paul said, they may say, well, what kind of body in 1 Corinthians 15? You know, he said, well, there's one that's going to be sown in incorruption. I mean, sown in corruption, raised in incorruption. It's sown in weakness and raised in power. Amen. All those loved ones that we have planted on the hill over here, one day when the last trump of God shall sound, I mean, they're going to be reunited with you and I in the air. They're going to have a new body. It's going to be transformed. They're there right now. They're not sleeping in the grave, by the way. When you take your last breath here, your loved one is over there in the presence of God. But what are they doing there? It's amazing to me that they have some type of body that's recognizable. It looks like you and I. It talks like you and I. And it hears like you and I. But it's not like the one that we have now. It's going to be a better one. It's going to be a glorious one. And it said there, as they were there, he prayed, his countenance, it was changed. Behold, and talked with him. I like that verse 30. It said, behold, there talked with him two men, which were Moses and Elijah, who appeared in glory, and they spake. So they're there, they're communing, they're in fellowship with the Lord Jesus Christ. They're talking with him. They're talking about the cross of Calvary. They're talking about his exodus that will be accomplished in Jerusalem. There we see them. There they're talking. And I believe that it is a witness to you and I that those that are going on to be with the Lord, I believe they're aware of what's going on. I believe that in anticipation that they're longing for the day that Christ calls the church home. I believe that they're there waiting for us. They're communing with the Lord Jesus Christ in perfect peace, perfect harmony. There they're talking. They're walking. It's just amazing to me that the Bible talks about a new body, one that is free from disease, one that is free from pain, one that is free from care, and one that walks and talks, but yet it is some type of body that cannot be explained, but yet it is a miraculous body. It's a glorified body. One that has the ability that one moment Moses and Elijah are there, and the next moment they're gone. It's not a disappearing act. This is just revelation of the new body that awaits the child of God. It's a real body, right? It's a body that is glorified. It's a body like the Lord Jesus Christ. Paul, John said, we'll see him as he is. And there we see as they're communing with one another, they're talking with one another, Moses and Elijah, now that they're gone. And here, Moses and Elijah, they're not elevated to the position of the Lord Jesus Christ because as Peter, in his confusion, he tries to just add Christ them to no man, or he said, and told no man in those days of those things which they had seen. Yeah. What did they see? They seen Jesus Christ revealed as the glorious Son of God. There was confirmation from the Father that he was the Son. And I like what Matthew said, that when he was transfigured, as this voice began to speak to them, they fell upon their face. And then Jesus came and he touched them and said, be not afraid. Jesus Christ gave peace. Jesus Christ still gives peace. And the peace that I want to relate to you through these two men, Moses and Elijah. Whether you love them, you and I, we go by the grave or we go in the rapture. One day we're going to receive a body like that appeared over James, John, and Peter there on that mountain. And the older I get, the better that it looks. And you think about all that we went through. You think about all that you have gone through this life. Those that you have seen that have suffered. Those that have been touched by affliction. Thank God, I believe here, as these two witnesses witness possibly, and we do know that they do witness the death, possibly the resurrection, possibly the ascension, and possibly there they preach the second coming of Jesus Christ. It preaches to you and I tonight. But, you know, you think about what Moses went through in his life. You think about what Elijah went through in his life. And there they're standing on the mountain talking with Jesus. Talking about what's going to make it all possible. The cross of Calvary. And there, they're in communion. There, they're in fellowship. There, they're in that glorified body. Well, that's a blessing within itself. But to think about, and maybe the question would arise one day after a while in glory, Moses, was it all worth it? What do you think Moses would say? Well, we know that it said, well, the writer of Hebrews said that he rejected the kingdom of Egypt just to walk with the people of God. Elijah, when all he went through, you think one day someone might ask Elijah, was all the troubles and trials worth it? Paul said, it cannot be compared with the glory of God. Let me tell you, one day it's going to be worth it. One day we're going to be changed in the moment and the twinkling of an eye. Those that are dead in Christ, I believe those, that would be under the classification there of Moses. Those that have died by the way of the grave. And then those of us that are alive and remain. Boy, that's going to be a glorious day. Boy, I tell you what, I'm glad and I'm looking forward to the day. I'm prepared should my day come by the way of the grave. I'm prepared. That's not the way I want to go, but I'm ready. Either way.
Amen.
But what I'm looking for, and I believe Paul was talking the same way, because the language said Paul, I believe, was looking for the rapture.
Yeah.
And those that are of us that are alive and remain will be like Elijah. One day we'll just be out of here. Gone to be with the Lord. Reunited with love. And I believe we'll have to look all over heaven to find them either.
No.
I believe that you'll recognize them just as soon as you lay eyes upon them. There the next time you see them. It won't be like we saw my granny laying down there in the bed, down there in Birmingham. Not going to be confined to wheelchairs. Not going to be hooked to machines and hoses and tubes, but a new, glorious body. Communion. Talking. That's what the Bible said there. That they talked. You know, that has the idea that they're just not talking to Jesus, but Jesus is talking back to them. And there they're communing together. It talks about fellowship.
Yeah.
I mean, what a glorious day when we go home to be with the Lord. And I'm glad it's all made possible because the Old Testament law and the prophet all pointed to his decease, his exodus. whom the next time we see our loved one in that new glorious, glorified body, that one like Jesus, that one that has no pain, no suffering, and yet I'll know them and they'll know me. I'm looking forward to the change. One day soon. And soon we shall be changed into the image of that of Christ. And there, I'm glad it was revealed to us and through his disciples here that this was the glorified one. This was God the Son in flesh. He robed himself in flesh, but it was revealed to him or to those disciples there, that new body that is awaiting you and I. Well, I tell you, we don't get up as easy as we used to. We don't see as good as we used to. We don't hear as good as we used to. Let me tell you, this old body you're dwelling now, this tabernacle is going back to the ground, going back to the clay in which it was made. But yet, the Bible talks about a new body. A new body. One that the Bible said is not a celestial, but a terrestrial. It's a body that we cannot explain, but yet I believe there's a long pulse, there's a long within each and every one of us. The Spirit of God within us is yearning for that transformation. But the confidence that I have tonight is that my loved ones are alive in heaven. Those that have died in the Lord, they just made their exodus from this walk of life to the next. And in a moment, in a twinkling of an eye, and someday in the near future, if we're alive and remain, we'll see them in that new body. We'll commune with them. We'll have fellowship with them. And there we worship the Lord, our Savior, for what he has done. You know, really, they were conversing there about one thing. And I really think that that is something that you and I should focus on this afternoon as we bring our sermon to a close, is that we should still converse with our loved ones about what Jesus has done for them on the cross of Calvary. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you tonight for the Word of God. We thank you for this opportunity to gather in your house. Thank you for the confidence that we place in your Word. God, we thank you for those that have preached, those that have testified, those that have mentioned Jesus Christ to us. And Father, we pray that you give confidence to those that may be struggling with the loss of a loved one. We pray that you give them comfort, that their loved ones are well. They're in that new glorified body like yours. And one day soon we'll put on that body. Like Peter said, like you showed him, we must put off this earthly tabernacle. Father, we pray you bless your Word. Go with us around the service in Jesus' name. Amen. You stand with us.